if but don't mind telling on the internet. My father burned down my childhood home for the insurance money. He took me along as his alibi, so I could verify he wasn't anywhere near it when it happened. I was 13 years old. I remember crying so hard knowing my clothes, books, photos, all of it would be destroyed. I wasn't allowed to save anything because he told me it would have been too suspicious. I found out years later he blamed it on me. Telling the fire chief, plus friends and family, the fire had started because I must have been secretly smoking in my bedroom. I've never smoked a cigarette in my life. That my dad paid my mom $1,500 for full custody of my youngest sibling. Not only would this be a massive blow to my sibling, but my dad remarried quite quickly and the new wife is the very definition of an evil stepmom. If my sibling knew that our mom gave her up for such a small sum of money and the trade-off was 5+ years of abuse, she would be destroyed. When I was an awkward tween, my brothers and I spent a lot of time at my grandparents' house. We had been raised by my grandparents since we were little kids, and even after my dad remarried, he and my stepmom both worked graveyard shift, so we would spend the night at my grandparents' house while my parents were at work. One day, my grandmother informed me that it was my grandfather's birthday and suggested that I wish him a happy birthday. He was downstairs in the living room sitting on the sofa, and I went up to him and gave him a big hug around the neck and said, "Happy birthday, Grandpa." It was kind of difficult to hug a person sitting down, so I ended up kneeling on the sofa between his legs rather than trying to hug him from a standing position. He was quite happy and gave me a hug back. When I pulled back from the hug, he held me in his arms and gave me a big smile. And then he put his tongue in my mouth. Sometimes when I was a little kid we would kiss other family members on the mouth, but those were chaste pecks on the lips. I could tell immediately that this was different. His tongue was on my teeth. It lasted only for a moment and I was grossed out and confused when I pulled away. At that moment my grandmother walked into the living room. I turned my head to look at her. My hands were still on my grandpa's shoulders. She seemed really happy that I had wished my grandfather a happy birthday like a good little kid. I gave him a final quick hug and scrambled out of the room. For the rest of my tween and teen years, I was always careful not to be alone in the same room with my grandfather. He passed away during my 20s, a good decade ahead of his time due to lifestyle-induced health issues, and my family chose me to speak at his funeral. I had really complicated feelings about it because I did love him. My grandma and grandpa raised me, after all. Also, my grandfather was the rock of the family and after he passed away, the three branches, my dad and our family, plus his siblings and their families, gradually grew apart, and nothing was ever the same between us again. We don't even spend Christmas all together anymore. I've never told anyone in my family about it because I couldn't break my grandmother's heart. She's survived her husband 10 years and still talks to and about him every day and visits his grave multiple times a week. I was raped with an implement in the youth room of my childhood church by my two best friends at the time. We were basically alone in the building at the time, one did it, and the other held me down. They thought it was a joke or funny, even once I started screaming. One of them had a moment of clarity and I suppose realized that what they were doing was wrong, and made the other person stop, and they sat there with me for a few minutes until I'd calmed down. Once I regained myself enough to stand, I racked one of them between the legs with a pool cue. Their parents were waiting in the parking lot, and they were going to call the cops on me until my friend confessed what they'd done to their parents. I was pressured into silence by the pastor at the parents' behest. I've told people, so I guess it's not technically a secret, but nobody's believed me because I'm a big guy, and always have been. The last person I tried to talk to about it actually smacked me in the face, so I guess I'll be dying with this one. You know those stories about girls in the 70s who went to live with an aunt for a year during high school? I did that. In 2008. I was a very naive teenager with irregular periods, and my friend thought it would be absolutely hilarious to buy those cheap pregnancy tests at Walmart and see what happened. We laughed the whole time, until one of them was positive. We couldn't remember which was which, so we got two more and turns out it was mine. That was when it dawned on me that I had had sex. My school did not offer any kind of sex education, and my parents were useless in that regard. I panicked and swore my friend to secrecy. I basically put it out of my mind until my clothes didn't fit anymore. I was always close with my older cousin and we were talking on the phone one night when she asked how school was going and I just dumped all of it on her. She came up with the perfect plan. It was already April and when I'd finally gotten the courage to go to Planned Parenthood they'd told me I was due in August. So my cousin called my mom saying there was this amazing summer music program in her town that I just had to attend, and that I could stay with her the whole time. My mom thought it was great, and the day after school ended I got on a plane to San Francisco. I stayed with my cousin, she went to all of my appointments with me, and she helped me find a social worker and eventually my daughter's parents. When I arrived back home before my junior year of high school started, my mom asked me how my summer was without really caring and then remarked that I must have lost a few pounds. My cousin died in 2012 in a car accident, and no one else knew apart from that one friend, the doctors I saw in Oakland, and the people involved in the adoption. I get a photo and a letter about the child once a year, and I send money for her college and a card for her birthday every year. When she turns 16, her parents are allowed to give her the cards if she wants them, but they are not permitted to pass any contact information along. I have no interest in meeting her or getting to know her personally. I know she's safe and comfortable and that's all I want. I will die before I tell anyone about her, and if my friend were to spill the beans I would deny it. I attempted to murder my mother. She was abusive, verbally but also physically. She'd hit you in places no one would see, or rip clumps of my hair out when Dad was on the road for work. She probably has a personality disorder. She got in my face one night when I was coming home from my second job, and I had it. My mom went through whole periods where she wouldn't work. I was killing myself every summer working 50 plus hours to pay family bills in my parents' names and also get my younger sister to all of her activities. I had it. I tried to put mom's head through a wall. She started screaming, "Oh, help! Help!" And I told her she could dish it out, she should also be able to take it, shoved her on the ground and kicked her repeatedly in the abdomen and thigh. While still trying to put her head through the wall with one hand, it's a plaster and lath situation, old house in New England. I really messed her up, and it felt good to do so. She's destroyed so many people's lives and she never faces any consequences for it. No one in our family ever helped me or called the police when she would abuse me. The only one who ever helped was the dog. If the dog was awake when my mom tried to start something, she'd get between us, growl at mom until she backed down. I had always shown restraint and never hit her until this night. But my dad did call the cops on me when I crossed that line. The cops get there, split us up to interview, I explain my side and then just blurt out, "Where were you buttholes when I was 8 and she was doing that to me?" The cop was taken aback, I think he could tell I was being honest and it was a culmination of years of pain. He goes and talks to his partner, "I think this isn't an assault, I think it's a mental illness thing." Then they basically intimidated my mom and dad into agreeing with them, they wouldn't let it go until they agreed it was a medical issue not a criminal one. So they called an ambulance and I went to the hospital as part of a diversion program. Basically, they sent me to detox for 3 days and I emerged with no record, no charges, no nothing except a script for Prozac and a recommendation for therapy, paid for by the state low-income insurance plan. Trying to kill my mom probably saved my life, honestly. Because I got myself some tools from a CBT therapist, but I'm not stupid enough to want people to know. Who would date me? How would I ever get promoted at work? Anyway, be kind. You never know what someone's been through and you never know what people are capable of when pushed far enough. I'm a guy. When I was around 9 to 10 I had a friend, also guy, who pushed me up against the wall and started jacking me off. He started doing this frequently and made me masturbate in front of him with one of my parents' personal massagers. I tried to tell on him one time but went back on it really quickly. I think my mom knew what was going on though. Felt a bit like Stockholm because he was one of my only friends back then and I was really scared and confused. Then another friend started dry humping me at a sleepover while student who had been in foster care but his mom worked her butt off to get him back and she did. He had to take a very important state exam. Him back and she did. He had to take a very important state exam. She called me and asked if he passed it. I looked at the grades and saw he did and said so. She burst into tears of joy and that is when I saw I had read the wrong score. He had failed. So I changed his grade to passing. No one knew. That was the only time I ever did that. That could have cost me my license. The weird thing is, when my awful corrupt principal pressured me to change other students' scores so we could raise our pass rate, I refused. I never told anyone what I did for my student. He went into the military, was extremely successful there, has a great wife and kids, so I think I did the right thing. F those tests. They aren't human. My cousin fucked a stripper during his bachelor party. Hours earlier, We randomly ran into his fiance and her friends, and she made a huge deal about him hitting a strip club, specifically because of this. He comes out of the champagne room and told me I think I just had sex with her. Only three people know this. Me, him, the stripper. So I'm never going to tell her, and I'm never going to bring it up to him ever. He's actually a good guy that unintentionally did a bad thing. He thought he was going to get a lap dance, but she veered him left to the champagne room. Granted, he could have walked out at any moment, but alcohol was also at play. He found guilty afterwards, and we were 16 hours away from the wedding ceremony. I wasn't going to make him feel guilty about it and ruin the wedding for them both. I think there's definitely a difference between having an affair and having a stripper ride your genital for 30 seconds. I lost my virginity at age 27 with a woman who was 58. She is a sweet lady who knew my mother and felt bad for me. It was pity sex, but I didn't care. I continued having sex with her for another 2 months until she ended it because I had grown sexually dependent on her. I'm 29 now, and she's still the only woman I've had sex with. On the bright side, it will be easy to take this secret to the grave since I know I'm gonna die alone. I've killed two men. They tried to rob me with a knife, but I always carried a Mora knife and I stabbed first. After I stabbed the first guy in the gut, the other guy pushed me against the wall and tried to hit me, but I managed to get him in under the ribcage. It was all over the local newspaper and I still have nightmares. I never notified the police, I just ran for it. I still have the knife though, because I feel like I'm not allowed to throw it away after that. Boobs stopped me from killing myself. No, really. I was suicidal in college and had made up my mind that I was going to overdose later in the week. While on my way to pick up the prescription that I would use for the deed, I ran into a friend from last year and I added her on Snapchat so that we could keep in touch. She ended up snapping me about 30 minutes later, and the first message she sent were her boobies. Let me tell you, there were some grade A boobies too. Obviously she wanted to smash. Over the next few days we went back and forth about finding an opportunity to get frisky. Mind you, we were both on campus and went to a Christian school, so we couldn't just walk into each other's room. Basically it ended up dragging out for a week. We never ended up smashing, but during the next week a spot opened up for me at the school counseling center, and I was admitted to a hospital when the counselor quickly realized I was suicide 28. I had one hooker every day. Boobies saved my life. I've had sex with at least 30 hookers. I lost my virginity to a hooker when I was 22. From 22 to about 28 I had one hooker every 6 months or so. When I was 36 I moved to San Diego and went across the border to Tijuana every 2 weeks and had sex with 2 to 3 every trip. Right before I left San Diego I had a male-female-female threesome, something that was a fantasy of mine basically forever. It was an amazing experience though I wish I had more time and there were less rules. That was in December 2017 and I haven't had sex since, not for a lack of trying. I almost made a trip to San Diego last month but decided against it at the last minute. I'm still wishing I went. That when I was 15 I tried to hang myself in my room. I was being bullied pretty bad, had no self-esteem, just got broken up with. I used my school tie over a curtain rail. When I jumped down the curtain rail snapped and I landed on the floor. I looked up and kinda laughed at the situation. Things got better. I am now nearly 30, have a beautiful wife, an amazing 5-year-old and a job I love. If you ever feel like there is no way out, then seek help. It can always get better. I have never told anyone this and am finding it very hard to hit the post button. But here goes. Thanks for listening to Radio TTS. Hit the subscribe button and activate the notification bell for more videos. Click the left